Things you see from the 70s. Like, we don't get to Turnstile without seeing the Ramones stuff, you know? Like, it's all connection. That's what the beauty of this museum is. And unfortunately, I feel like a lot of the more popular music has gotten, the more popular punk rock music has gotten since the 90s. The industry plays a role in things, and some bands don't get along. Music business takes over, but really in the long-term essence of what punk rock is. We're going to start from the 70s, we're going to get to today, and almost everything I'm going to talk about has some importance to Bayside and myself.
You're pulling out your teeth, and on the NOFX you
similar to like a CBGB's up in the Bay, was called Gilman Street. Bayside never got to play there. A couple years ago, probably 2017 or so, we played Oakland for the first and only time, and I had my bike with me. We were playing nowhere near Gilman Street. I grabbed my bike out of the trailer and rode my bike about 5 miles just to go stand outside of Gilman Street. It wasn't open, it wasn't anything, but it just meant so much to me to be somewhere that literally Green Day started out, Operation Ivy. I mean, I don't know that there's anything more legendary in this entire museum than Tim Armstrong's guitar from Operation Ivy. I mean, Operation Ivy is legitimately, they put one record out, kind of changed everything. Tim and Matt went on to be in Rancid after that, which then changed everything again. Tim Armstrong still one of the coolest people on Earth. And when they were literal teenagers, they put out a record in 1989 that is still absolutely. So, fun fact, the highest selling independent record of all time, Offspring Smash.
kind of wild. That's so, what's that say? 11 million records? I'm sure it's more than that at this point. But I mean, there's higher selling records, but they're all on major labels, MxPx and Celine Dion, whatever, you know, Garth Brooks, independent records. And that all had to do with, again, Bad Religion, the Brett Gurewitz. Has so much to do with all of this. So you start to get into, believe me, this, I ran right to this when I cried. When I first walked in here, I ran right to Billy Joe's. This is one of his guitars that was part of this. So, I highly suggest getting a little closer to a bunch of this stuff. We do have a Taken Back Sunday Gold record. They still have the same manager, Jillian. Very cool. But this is the stuff that really, this is, I never would have picked up a bass if it wouldn't have been for Green Day. I mean, again, I said that Green, my love of Green Day turned into me discovering Bad Religion and a way to think and a way to be smart and a way to look at the world that I still feel that way to this day. So, and then you see how a lot of these bands, they all just played with each other all the time. Green Day and Rancid, you know, like.
What was your first bass?
It was some crappy Ibanez that cost probably like $150 that I lost at some point. Not lost, but when I was a senior in high school is when me, Vinnie Caruana, and a couple other people, Eddie from Taking Back Sunday, this era, started the movie life. I was 17 years old, and Eddie came up to me in that warehouse I told you about, the PWAC. He came up to me one day and this is how really it all started. He came up to me and was like, you go to every show, do you play any instruments? I'm like, yeah, I play bass, I play a little guitar, whatever. He's like, I'm starting a new band. Do you want to play bass? And I was just like, yeah, sure, let me ask my mom. You know, I'm like 17. And Eddie at that point was 24. When I was 17, I was all around a lot of people who were like 5, 6, 7 years older than me. And like, really, when I think back about how, like, I'm so grateful that they weren't like, get out of here, you little twerp, you know? Like, I don't know. I think that they just saw that I really wanted to be in bands and tour and all this stuff. I mean, I graduated high school in the summer of 98. I was 17. And I went on tour for 2 months straight. No cell phones, no nothing. I don't know how my parents ever let me do that, but it was the time of my life. And every show that we got to, there was like this many people there for 2 months straight. You know, like nobody saw us ever. But, you know, I wouldn't trade it for the world. It was amazing. Here's another Bad Religion guitar for Brett Gurewitz. Very cool. Let's see. Okay. Over here, I know I've brought up Nirvana a bunch. Nirvana, obviously super important to just the world. But here's a Kurt Cobain leather jacket with a bunch of passes and stuff on it. And I'll show you this photo of Kurt Cobain sitting on this couch. And if you want to sit on the couch that Kurt Cobain sat on, you should sit on it. Because it's right there. Yeah, I mean, I don't think that this era would happen without Nirvana, and I like Nirvana. Like the first two CDs I bought, my grandmother worked at Kmart. The first two CDs I bought were, this is how I've always been so all over the place with my music taste. I bought two CDs that day. It was Nirvana, Nevermind, and whatever Paula Abdul record. I'm like, it's all the same, it's just music, I like it, whatever. So yeah. Feel free. I mean, everyone should sit on a couch Kurt Cobain sat on. The face to face of the man who sold the world. Back in that era, yeah. Right here.
Yeah.
Back in that era, absolutely. And it just was a little too grimy for me.
For
yeah. I was like, I need some sing-alongs here. So I do want to take a picture with everyone here, because we're going to take a picture together at some point, but being that this is my favorite wall, I want to take a picture with everyone here, so
come on this.
Yeah.
Again, when we've been recording with Cameron Webb, we were in California recording at Tarobang, and we went to the Foo Fighters' personal studio. They were not there. We went to their personal studio to record just the drums because they had such an amazing drum room. And I bring up Motorhead because Dave Grohl's obsessed with Lemmy. And there's a giant Motorhead flag in the drum room hanging. And then there's a massive, the size of the entire side of the building, mural of Lemmy on the side of the Foo Fighters studio. So that was cool. We were literally not allowed to take pictures in there. I'm not joking when I say, like, went to the bathroom in the studio and there was like a Nirvana and Three Moon Man holding the toilet paper. It's like that kind of stuff. I'm just like, I'm a slightly sentimental person and I didn't know how much like Nirvana and Foo Fighters like more meant to me. This way, we're gonna start to see. Oh yeah, okay. So now we get to more Bayside era type stuff, including some Bayside stuff. So, I will go through everything and show you the Bayside things last. So we have stage worn stuff from Stage Chance, a bass from Starting Line. Maybe you know, maybe you don't know, Mark Hoppus produced at least one, if not two, Motion City soundtrack records. If you're a fan of AFI, these are from the Girls Not Grey record video. Right here, a very cool, ahead of their time, like little kind of fun collectible box set that Mike Ken did on their, I guess, probably their last record, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, still look there, yeah, that's Bayside, and I'll show you that last. This is kind of amazingly awesome. Obviously, this is a Taking Back Sunday item, but what this card says, hand-embroidered vest made by Melissa Hoffman. Melissa Hoffman is one of, like, the ultra-super passionate fans of, like, Taking Back Sunday and Bayside, and she's flown everywhere in the country to see both of our bands, sees us 10, 15 times on every tour. Like, just somebody who just, like, I can't not recognize you. You're at every show. How do you have money to do this? You know, like that sort of thing. So I'm very happy for her that not only is, I mean, I'm happy for Taking Back Sunday having a couple things in here, but the fact that she has an item she made for Taking Back Sunday in here, very happy for her. Let's see, all time low stuff here. I will bring up the fact, okay, so this is a guitar that Jack used on the road for a little bit. The headstock is broken off. That's awesome. But there's lyric sheets that are printed out here from Walking Wounded. This song here is the Dear Your Holiness. But the working title for Dear Your Holiness was Found Me Here, which is just a lyric in the chorus. And then even before, that's a printout from when Anthony was actually in the booth singing. So we have lyrics written out. This notebook probably has so much gold in here. The song that is displayed here is Rite of Passage off of the Walking Wounded. So these are handwritten lyrics. The working title on that just says, I'm ready to go. If we could open this up right now, I guarantee there's lyrics from Duality in there, Walking Wounded, like that. Probably the whole record has lyrics in there. So the museum decided to pick that one. I'm not sure why, but yeah, I mean, I absolutely gratitude that we're a part of this at all. You know, it's the coolest thing. One day, Nick will have something in here. But I'm just so happy that Bayside has anything in here. And amongst, you know, it's hard to, you know, it's interesting to like focus on your career and your goals and all this stuff, and you kind of forget sometimes that you're a part of it. You know, it's like, yeah, I want to be as big as Fall Out Boy. I want to be as big as Taking Back Sunday, blah, blah, blah. And you kind of always have these goals to reach for. And then you just forget that, oh, no, we are. We're here. We're good. So it's really great to see it all kind of just like this. What else? There's some cool Alkaline Trio stuff here, too. So yeah, get a little, I've tried to take video of that guitar when I was here last.
Her favorite song to hear is Strangest.
My favorite too.
She likes Strangest Faces to listen to.
Big festival in the UK, which is kind of rare for us because we don't play there often. And we were backstage, and I can picture it right now. Anthony had his guitar like on the floor in a case somewhere, and he just comes in, opens the guitar case, and just plays that riff. And I was like, dude, that was sick. What was that? He's like, I don't know, I was just like humming it, and I was like, cool. And then like months later we wrote the song, and I was like, dude, I remember you like rushing in to like play that part real quick that you just thought of, and now it's like, I mean, we still play that song to this day.
What's the bass line to When I Come Around? Bum 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 bum. Try to do that. I don't know if she remembers it. She did it like 2 weeks ago for her. Almost.
Was that drop
D? No, I don't think so.
Yeah, that's it. I remember another fun memory. I remember a high school talent show. Me and my friends all played. We were already musicians, but another group of kids were on stage. We didn't play. But another group of kids were on stage, and we played When I Come Around, and the bass player didn't do any of the fills. And I was like, that's one of my favorite songs to play.
This guy's not even doing it.
I know I'm not doing it at all. It's all the same, it's just music, I like it, whatever.